Executive Director of the Center for European Studies. CES is really pleased to put on this event tonight, and I want to give a shout out to a few folks out here. So European Horizons, thanks for having your meeting here tonight. Great organization to be a part of. Thanks for all you guys do. The TAM students, Translink Master students in the house, thank you for coming. Looking forward to your great questions. And the Euro majors, I also see many of you. So yes, this is the center, all of these groups in one. We're really glad to have all of you great students and work with you every day. Please ask lots of great questions, and this is a wonderful speaker we have tonight. It's my pleasure to introduce Shane Stevens, the General Consul of, or the Consul General, sorry, of Ireland in Atlanta. He assumed his post in Atlanta in July 2015 as only the second Irish Consul General for the U.S. Southeast region, which includes Georgia, Alabama, Florida, Mississippi, North and South Carolina, and Tennessee. We're so glad that your power is back on and that everything's okay at home. Since joining Ireland's Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade in 2001, Mr. Stevens has served as Ireland's embassies to Tanzania, the Holy See, the European Union, Nigeria, and most recently Malaysia. Immediately prior to this post, he was working as the Assistant Chief of Protocol for the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade in Dublin, responsible for arranging many President Stevens' visits abroad and incoming presidential visits to Ireland. He received his BA in history, right, from Trinity College Dublin, and holds an MSc in Political Economy of Transition in Europe from the LSE. He hails from Dublin and is married with 4 children. Congratulations to that, too. Thank you very much for being here this evening. We're looking forward to a great discussion. And yes, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to try and stand up, but if I get tired, I'll fall down and that's it. So thank you very much indeed, Kathleen, for welcoming me here to UNC. It's great to be back in North Carolina. It's great to be back in UNC. Thank you. And I'm very glad to be introduced by someone called Kathleen Shanahan Lindner. Yes. It's a great Irish-American name. And also, my only true Irish-American relation also was called Kathleen.
Oh, right.
Kathleen Morovitz. Kathleen Singh Morovitz, but really, we say the Singh bit, but she's really called herself Kathleen Morovitz. And she died about a week ago in New York at 90. She was an academic in NYU for many years. So it's a name I'm very fond of, very fond of. And as you've heard, I'm Shane Stevens. I'm the Irish Consul General covering the Southeast of the United States. I'm the second person who's had that job. And I'm someone who's quite comfortable, I hope, speaking about EU affairs. I've been a practitioner in this area in my career, working. I worked in the European Commission as an intern, as a stagiaire many years ago, and then I went back and worked in our permanent representation, which is sort of our embassy to the European Union, some years ago, where I was working closely in the European Council and also in the European Parliament. So I've done a few European things over the years, and. Please feel free at any stage, particularly at the end, to ask any other questions about my previous experience working in the European institutions, or really anything you like at all, anything that comes into your heads. Please do feel free to ask questions. I know not all of you are political science or European studies people, so please ask about anything that you think might be fun. Working for the Irish Consulate, we very much work as part of a network. The Irish Consulate in the Southeast is one of 6 Irish consulates around the U.S. We all report up to an ambassador based in Washington. A new ambassador just arrived just a few weeks ago, Dan Mulhall. Both of our previous ambassadors have spoken here in UNC, so I'm hoping to get this one down here fairly soon.
Okay.
I'm working on that.
Okay.
And we also, in European terms, we're also very conscious of the fact that there is an EU delegation in Washington, which is currently headed up by another Irish man, thankfully, at the moment, which is a good sign. It's not the first time we've had an Irish person heading up as EU ambassador to the US, and it hopefully won't be the last time. I mean, that says something about the particularly special relationship that Ireland has as a bridge between the European Union and the US. So I'm here today to try and say a few things about Ireland and the European Union. I'm talking about Ireland and the European Union because you can't really make sense of Ireland without talking about the European Union at the same time. The two things are, we are very much deeply and inherently part of the European Union in everything we do. I'm also going to talk a little bit about the Irish perspective on Brexit. It's a topical thing, but the word is used too much in speeches these days, but I'm going to do it anyway. And then a little bit about Ireland and North Carolina. And finally, a few little comments about the future of the transatlantic relationship, the relationship between the European Union and the United States. So first of all, the EU and Ireland. You know, our official line is a line that I agree. The European Union is a home that we helped to build. That's what the European Union is for us. We weren't there at the very beginning. We weren't the founders of the European Union. But Ireland, we've been a member of the European Union since before I was born. And since before when our current Prime Minister was born. So it's absolutely inherent to what we are. And one of the reasons we're so happy about the European Union and so committed to it is because the European Union has allowed us to develop in a way that would not have been possible otherwise. Today, Ireland is one of the most open and globalized countries in the world, and we are, I like to be modest sometimes, but we are one of the most successful countries in the world. Despite our tiny size, we have only about 5 million people in Ireland, so it's a small place, but we've been successful coming from a background of poverty. You know, Ireland was most famous for its potato famine. It was famous for sending its sons and daughters abroad in difficult circumstances for hundreds of years. But since the 1970s, when we joined the European Union, we've had steady, almost continuous progress, and we've made great strides. Today, according to the UN Human Development Index, we're ranked number 8 out of 188 countries in the world in terms of our wealth, in terms of education standards, in terms of health standards, in terms of longevity, security, across the board. And then a very different ranking agency, Forbes, ranks us as the fourth best place to do business in the world. So that's, again, two very different ranking schemes, and we're doing well on both of them. And we've come so far very much in the context of the European Union. So in the early days, the European Union was a great source of funding for Ireland. They helped fund many of the great roads we have in Ireland today. They helped fund infrastructure of every kind. They also encouraged and at times forced Ireland to adopt modern, progressive social and environmental legislation, which has been great for us. The European Union has these high standards, and we have contributed to those high standards. As a member of the European Union, we built that house with the other countries. And you know, we've gradually raised our standards across the board in a whole huge range of areas, from you know how we regulate water quality to the kinds of procedures you have to go through before you can fire someone in Ireland. And that process has been enormously beneficial. Also, the European Union has allowed us to open up our economy to the world as a small, weak, poor country. There were a lot of risks for us to do that on our own. But as part of the European Union, we've been able to do it very, very effectively. And we've also been given this wonderful access to the single European market. So we have been able to freely export our goods and get cheap goods from all across that huge regulated realm of over 500 million consumers. That's been a great benefit to Irish consumers, and a huge benefit to Irish companies who we've been able to export our beef and our milk and our expertise all around the European Union in a wonderful way, and it's been vitally important to our economy. And in recent times, it hasn't been a sort of a one-way street. In decades, it hasn't been just a matter of us getting things from the European Union. We've been also, we are have in recent years been net contributors to the European Union budget. We've been helping to build, to some extent, roads in the new member states who are now poorer than us, for example, in some places in Eastern Europe. But the European Union has continued to make absolute sense for us. And today, while some people are in other nearby countries to Ireland have taken a different perspective, today over 80% of Irish people are committed to our continued membership of the European Union. So not only did it make sense in the past to help get us to where we are now, but it makes sense for us now. So I'm going to say a little bit more about that. So today, the European Union is vital for us on a number of levels. The most obvious one is one that rings very clearly here in the States. The European, we are now, as a key element, member of the European Union, we are probably, well, I would argue at least, the best possible location for US investment into the European Union. So we are a gateway for aggressive, confident American companies who want to reach out and take advantage of this huge market. American companies generally aren't so interested in coming to Ireland because of our 5 million or so market. They're interested in coming into Ireland to access the 500 million consumers in the European Union. That's why so many American companies have invested in Ireland in recent years. And they're also interested in Ireland because we have the youngest population in the European Union. We have, by many statistics, the best educated population in the European Union. And we are a, thanks in part to the role that the European Union played, a deeply open country, a country that's open to people coming in from the outside. We welcome foreign talent. For example, Google in Ireland, mostly doesn't employ Irish people. You know, 60% of the employees of Google in Ireland come from across the European Union and across the world. And that's a negative thing for us. That's a positive thing for us. We're a place where global talent likes to come. So that's a way in which the European Union works well for us in terms of the single market serving us, allowing us to be a great destination for investment. Also, European Union citizenship makes sense for Irish people. I have my passport here in my pocket, which is an Irish passport, but simultaneously a European Union passport. And we are committed members of the European Union. We are glad to be part of this larger project. We know that the European Union was a vital peace process in its origins, of course. With some helpful advice and encouragement and money from the US under the guidance of General George Marshall, the Marshall Plan, that kicked off around 70 years ago, the European Union was, in a way, the solution to the horrors of the Second World War. You know, the European Union was a means of, you probably all have heard this a million times, a way of binding together the countries, the nation states of Europe together so tightly so they could never again do something like the Second World War, or the First World War, and ultimately they we wouldn't see something such as the Holocaust happening again within the borders of the European Union. So it's been successful in that regard, and we are therefore very proud of being European Union citizens in Ireland. And also, from a more practical point of view, we find that we are able to project our interests internationally extremely effectively through the European Union foreign policy. And I mean foreign policy in the very broadest sense. And we're also able to project our values through that foreign policy in a way that would be utterly impossible for a tiny country of 5 million people to do on its own. So perhaps the most dramatic example of this is in the area of trade. So for decades, the European Union has been responsible for negotiating all the trade deals for the European Union member states. And it does that very, very effectively. Sometimes with Irish European Union civil servants, they're in the lead. David O'Sullivan, in fact, who's the current EU ambassador to the United States, was previously a European Union trade negotiator. So with the help of people like David O'Sullivan, over the years, we have been getting the best possible trade deals with India, with China, with Brazil, most recently and most impressively with Canada through CETA, and through and with Japan. Those trade deals, which allow the best possible terms of trade for Irish companies, would have been utterly impossible for us to achieve on our own. It would be laughable, the idea that we could have got those on our own. Also, through European Union foreign policy, we're able to project our values. We're able to significantly have an impact around the world on the promotion of human rights and on the promotion of democracy. Things that we do very often in concert with the US State Department, but through primarily European Union institutions. Also, it's very much the same thing on the development side. Ireland is a committed player in the world of development, but probably the biggest role we have is by our influence on the structure of European Union common development spending. So we play a role with the other member states, probably a role that's disproportionate to our small size, in deciding how European Union development money is spent. And that again allows us to have a massive global impact. So in all these areas, we're able to have a huge impact as members of the European Union today that would be impossible for us otherwise if we were an independent member state. So that's why we're so committed to the European Union going forwards. Again, I want to mention just two or three other things before I go on to the next category. Migration and regulation. Two of the biggest bogeyman words used in the Leave campaign for those who are pushing for the UK to leave the European Union are actually, they're terms that we're not so scared of in Ireland. In Ireland, we have had massive migration. Percentage-wise, we've had much more migration than the UK or anywhere else in the European Union in recent times, but I mean in terms of migration from within the European Union. So we've had more migration from other European Union countries into Ireland over the last 20 years than I think you've seen anywhere else. When I grew up, less than 1% of the population were born outside the country. Today, 20% of our population was born outside the country. And that's a massive change in a very short period of time. And we have overall embraced that change. We now would find it very difficult to get on in our daily lives without Polish bakeries. We wouldn't get on well without Polish restaurants or Polish workers, whether they're barbers or working in butcheries, computer scientists, or priests. And again, our churches wouldn't be that full. Catholic churches in Ireland wouldn't be so full if it wasn't for the Poles and it wasn't for the other people from Eastern Europe coming in. So that change has been a very positive one for us overall. And again, regulation is often spoken about as, oh, it's terrible in the European Union, they force you to have straight bananas and they force you all these unnecessary rules on businesses and you constrain them. But that's utterly a misguided understanding. A single market of 500 million consumers can only operate in a real sense if you do have regulation about what's legal and what is not legal in that large market. So you have to have a certain level of regulation to have a single market working. And we're very happy with it. We contribute every year to the redrawing and the adjusting of European regulation. And we, I think, often as partners in the EU processes, we have punched above our weight. We've been very effective in those negotiations. So we're immensely happy with having this body of EU regulation. It's been a good thing for Ireland. It allows the single market to work. As I've already explained, the single market is of massive benefit to Ireland in many ways. And again, another a smaller thing that's probably less in the headlines, the European Union was also very positive for Ireland in terms of our relationship with the United Kingdom and the peace process in Northern Ireland. It was in the context where Ireland and the UK were almost equal partners inside the European Union that we became close friends and partners as we are today. It wasn't the only factor at all in what brought us to the great state of Anglo-Irish relations today, but it was an important factor. And very often, we were on the same side of the negotiating table with the UK, let's say on tax matters, in terms of pushing forwards a pro-market approach. We were very often negotiating with the UK. So we developed a great rapport, closer relations, a better understanding with the UK as members together in the European Union. And also then, separately, the European Union played an important role in funding peace processes and community reconciliation in Northern Ireland in a way that was a very important facilitating process for the peace process there. It wasn't the key thing, but it was an important facilitating factor. So let me move on to Brexit now. From what I've said so far, I think you're going to be able to guess whether I'm in favor of Brexit or not. Does Ireland think that Brexit is a good thing or a bad thing? We think Brexit was a bad thing. We campaigned against the UK leaving the European Union for months. Though we didn't expect Brexit to happen, we prepared for it. And we pushed through campaigns to encourage the public and politicians in Northern Ireland to try a different path. They didn't choose to do that in the end, and we respect the decision. Even today, however, if they wanted to change their minds, we would be delighted. We don't think that's going to happen, but we leave the door open for them, as our Taoiseach has been saying recently. The reason we were so opposed to them leaving was multifold. We were worried about their departure affecting the excellent state of the peace process in Northern Ireland. That was our greatest concern, and still today remains our greatest concern in relation to Brexit. The Good Friday Agreement, which was a pact between, which was basically approved by the populations of Ireland and Northern Ireland simultaneously in referenda, and approved by the governments of the UK and Ireland, has been an excellent game changer for Northern Ireland, has brought huge peace dividends. While it isn't still fully implemented, it is absolutely the only game in town in terms of achieving progress in Northern Ireland. So we've been worried about anything that the UK leaving the European Union could do in terms of harming that. We've also been very much worried about having any new barriers come up between trade between Ireland and the UK, because the UK is a vital trading partner for Ireland. The UK is the number one destination for Irish agricultural goods, and still agricultural production is a very important part of our economy. Again, we were concerned about there being a hard border between Ireland and Northern Ireland. Politically, of course, Northern Ireland has for decades been part of the United Kingdom. But in practice, the border between Ireland and Northern Ireland is invisible. You don't notice it if you're driving from Dublin to Belfast. You can whiz up there in about just over 2 hours now. There's no visible border. The road signs change when you're on one side of the border to the other, but it's an almost invisible border. And ordinary people, businesses, families operate across the border smoothly at all times, with no difficulties now. So anything that would stop that was of great concern to us. But anyway, the UK decided to leave, and we're having to make the best of it. So the Irish government has, as one of its really top priorities since Brexit was announced last year, we've been working to mitigate the damage from Brexit, and also to find a silver lining for ourselves. We didn't want it to happen, but now that it's happening, we can see some advantages for Ireland. So in terms of mitigation of the damage, we've been working hard from the even before Brexit was decided upon by the British electorate to let the UK side know our perspective and fully take account of our perspective, our concerns about the peace process, the border, and our economic relationship. I've done the same thing just as forcefully with our European Union partners. And thankfully, so far, it seems like those efforts by our government have been effective. The negotiating papers released by the UK side and by our side, the European Union team, led by the European Commission, have fully taken account of our concerns. And in fact, interestingly, the European Council, that's the European Prime Ministers all meeting together, agreed that and this was quite a political decision, and perhaps going a little bit further than we might have perhaps guess they would, agreed clearly that if in the future the people of Northern Ireland were to decide by referendum that they wish to join Ireland, the European Union leaders said that automatically Northern Ireland will be allowed access to the European Union, that Northern Ireland would automatically be allowed to join the European Union, which was quite a big deal indeed, and something we were very happy about. But it was entirely in line with the terms of the Good Friday Agreement. The Good Friday Agreement says that the people of Northern Ireland have a right to be wholly British, wholly Irish, or British and Irish, whatever they want. And the territory there will stay part of the United Kingdom until the majority of people in Northern Ireland by a referendum decide to join Ireland, if they ever decide to do so, and they may never decide to do that. That was the principle of the Good Friday Agreement, so we're delighted that our European Union partners have continued to follow the spirit and the law of that agreement fully. So negotiations have been going well so far. And again, our European partners in the UK have been sensitive to the potential economic damage that Brexit could cause us. But the sticking point and the difficult issue will be, despite all these good words and the good principles expressed by all sides, it will still be difficult to organize to have a border between Ireland and Northern Ireland, which will be a border between inside the European Union and outside the European Union. It will be difficult to organize such a border that is frictionless and invisible. So that the way in which that challenge will be overcome is still to be seen. It's still to be seen. So that's a difficult part of negotiations, which are ongoing as we speak, led by Michel Barnier on the European Union side. So that's Ireland and Brexit. Now let me just, before I finish up on Brexit, I'll just mention that silver lining. We have to remember the silver lining. We didn't want Brexit, but we will take advantage of any silver lining we can find. So we have recently submitted applications to have two of the big European Union agencies that were based in the UK move to Ireland. So the European Union agency that was in charge of pharmaceuticals and the European Union agency that was in charge of financial services have both been in the UK. They can no longer continue to be in the UK because the UK is leaving the European Union. So we've put in bids to have those agencies join us. We've also been quite clear in communicating to global companies and even some British companies that, you know, now that the UK is leaving the European Union, it will not be an ideal location for some kinds of business operations. If you want to have a European Union headquarters, which deals inherently with projecting across the European Union, using the technical term passporting across the European Union, then the UK is not going to be the best destination for you in the future when you're out of the European Union. Because there are a whole range of technical advantages to being based in the European Union country and projecting from there to the rest of the single market compared to being outside the European Union and trying to project in there. Trade barriers, passporting rights in terms of services, regulatory conformity, a whole range of issues make it a huge advantage to be inside the European Union with your headquarters if you want to project and do business across the European Union. So Ireland now is going to be the only English-speaking country in the European Union. So we're going to be an obvious destination for such operations. Already we were doing very well in that regard. In recent years, it's been the Netherlands, the UK, and Ireland, at quite even levels, have been the main destinations for example, US FDI into Europe. And even though we're much smaller than the other two countries, we've been getting comparable amounts of FDI. In the Dutch case, a lot of that FDI has been sort of financially based rather than substantive investment. But in the Irish case and the UK case, it's been more similar. But we're certainly going to have a major advantage over the UK going forwards as a destination for global investment, whether it's from the US, Japan, or elsewhere, in terms of you know, investment in the European Union. And that's already been seen quite dramatically, again, in the financial services sector. Just in recent times, we had a great announcement from Bank of America, headquartered here in North Carolina, down the road in Charlotte, that they're going to put their European legal entities, I think is the technical term, into Ireland. And the Barclays Bank has also made some announcements about investment into Ireland. I think Morgan Stanley and a number of other big banks have announced their intention to put European Union-specific operations into Ireland. Now, already in Ireland, we have 10 out of the top 10 global internet companies are already based in Ireland. Already, it's about 9 out of the top 10 global pharmaceutical companies are already based in Ireland. And now we're moving in the same direction with the banking sector. Soon we're going to have 15 out of the top 20 banks globally already based in Ireland. And Brexit is certainly helping us in that regard. So we didn't want Brexit. We campaigned against it, but we're going to try and take advantage of the silver lining from Brexit for our economy. So let me turn now away. We've been looking at Europe, we've been looking at the UK and Ireland. Now let's turn to North Carolina. Ireland has a long and historic relationship with North Carolina. We have been coming here for hundreds of years in very large numbers. Scots-Irish and Catholic-Irish people have been coming here for generations and generations. If you don't believe me, you can check your Civil War graves. You can check listen to your country music songs. And you can look at the records and see who built your bridges and your roads and your canals. Irish people have made their mark in this state for generations. 10% or more of people, I think it's actually more, 12% perhaps of people in North Carolina have claim Irish heritage or Scots-Irish heritage as their number one heritage background. So we have a long legacy here. But in the old days, we were coming here often in difficult times, often fleeing from poverty in Ireland, particularly during the potato famine. But today, it's the pattern of our engagement here is slightly different. Today, we look upon North Carolina as a natural bedfellow. We see North Carolina as a natural partner for Ireland because of the great similarities between our economic and social models and our educational models. Ireland today has a strong profile as a place with an innovation economy where we attract high-tech pharmaceutical, IT, and finance investment. Again, that's the profile that North Carolina has. We are known as a location with great universities, a great place to do business, and we have an exceptional natural environment. Again, sounds a little bit like North Carolina. And in particular, the hubs of Raleigh and Charlotte are very, very attractive to Irish companies. The financial services sector have a natural affinity with Charlotte, and then here it's often about the biotech sector, though there's a bit of, and IT is in both locations. So that is nice in principle, but we've actually seen quite a lot of investment going in both directions. The overall picture of investment flows between Ireland and the US they're the core of the relationship today. We have 70% of all FDI in Ireland, foreign direct investment in Ireland, comes from the United States. About 140,000 very high quality jobs in Ireland are produced by American companies. But the relationship is much more reciprocal than you might think, especially considering the tiny size of Ireland. We employ between 80 and 100,000 people in Irish companies in the US. One Irish company based in Atlanta called Oldcastle on its own employs 40,000 Americans. Right here in North Carolina, we have one Irish company based down the road in Durham that employs 700 people in high-tech jobs. That's Icon. Mm-hmm. I think Kathleen got to meet some of the Icon people at an event we had at the Wake Chamber not too long ago. Again, that Irish company, Oldcastle, employs hundreds of people here. We have another Irish company called Rockall Tech, which is a big tech company in Charlotte. There are other companies, the one called Carn, the HR company, is established in Charlotte. And then we have new companies coming in all the time. There's a new telecoms company called Quibic, and just sounds like a, something that Harry Potter would play. But they just come in, I'm like, the name was Quibic, I think that is something to do with Harry Potter. But they've come in and just announced their investment into Charlotte just a few weeks ago. So it's an ongoing pattern of increasing investment in both directions. And of course, going in the other way, our big investors from North Carolina include Ingersoll Rand, we have Red Hat, we have SAS, we have Citrix, partially they can consider Florida-based or North Carolina-based, but they're big in Ireland. All big investors in Ireland because of the exceptional investment climate we offer. So those investment relationships are a core of the current contemporary relationship. And it's because that I personally believe that there is huge potential in the relationship between Ireland and North Carolina, that I'm coming here so often, that I'm here today, that I've been going to your chamber, and that I'm trying to work with the University of North Carolina on a big cultural project that will celebrate those great roots we have in the area of country music. And also, it's because of those strong links and the potential in our relationship, because of that we've chosen to put we only have three honorary consuls in the southeast of the US, and one of them is here in North Carolina. In Charlotte, unfortunately, but he comes up here very often. And so that's really what I could say initially about the relationship between Ireland and North Carolina. I could go into much more. There are Gaelic football teams here in North Carolina, in Charlotte and Raleigh. It's not a surprising fact to many people. A lot of Irish bars here, a lot of Irish restaurants, and a lot of Irish action generally, and a lot of Irish academics as well in this university. So it's a wide-ranging relationship, but that's just to touch on enough for now. So now to my broader and more ambitious theme, the future of the transatlantic relationship. So what does Ireland, little old Ireland, have to say about that? How could a small country like Ireland possibly have anything interesting to say about that? Well, I think we can say something. Ireland has traditionally, despite its small size, been a very important player in the European Union. We've not only ended up having a lot of the EU ambassadors to the US have been Irish citizens, but a lot of the heads of the European Commission have over the years been European Irish citizens. Again, we have a strong reputation for negotiating effectively within the European Union. And some of the most effective presidencies of the European Union under the old presidency-based model were organized by Irish governments. And again, we clearly have a special role in terms of linking the United States and Ireland. I mean, traditionally, I mean, the UK certainly would have claimed a unique role in terms of a bridge culturally and in terms of language between Europe and the United States. And again, they will continue to be an important bridge for organizations such as NATO. But they were often more bilateral anyway in their approach, rather than being committed members of the European Union, representing that European Unionist perspective here. Whereas in Ireland, we are, as I've said, committed Europeans, but with our eyes always on the United States. The typical refrain in Ireland is, "Oh, are we closer to Boston or Berlin?" It's a common phrase in Ireland. Most people often think about it because while we're committed members of the European Union, we do always look to the U.S. model for influence, and our leaders look in that way. And I'll speak a little bit more about one of our leaders, our new Prime Minister Leo Varadkar, who thinks in American terms very clearly, in a minute. So we're natural leaders, and in terms of the relationship, pushing for a European focus on the United States, and pushing for the United States to consider European views. And also within the European context, we're very often pushing a kind of an American agenda, at least on economic issues. We are very often the party in the European Union which is pushing for a more market-orientated approach, which is pushing for more focus on the innovation economy. We're very often the one that's pushing for deregulating markets, opening up the gas market or the electricity market. We very often have a very similar perspective to the, to Americans on those market issues within the European Union. So I think given those factors, and given the fact that we're about to become the only English-speaking country in the European Union, I think we're going to have an important part to play in leading this transatlantic relationship. And I think it is, of course, very, very, you know, reasonable to talk about the kind of increasing diversity of global international relations. And of course, India, China are coming to have a much greater role in global affairs than was previously the case, rightly. And again, Africa is coming up strongly now in a way that we are certainly very happy about. But still, if you look at the hard figures, the European-US relationship is core. I mean, just on the pure, in terms of pure commercial terms, we would, Kathleen and I were looking at the figures before the meeting. You know, EU investment into the US in 2016, in terms of FDI investment from the European Union into the US in 2016, was worth, I think, over $360 billion. And again, in the other direction, US investment into Europe was worth, I think, $220 billion in 2016. That is huge. That is sort of more than, well over more than half of all global FDI. So that economic relationship is enormously strong. And again, I'm a big fan of China, and Ireland prioritizes China, but US investment into Ireland is many multiples of current US investment into China. That is, it's kind of shocking to hear that, but that is the current financial reality. So I think we must remember that this relationship is core. Again, who has been the key partner for the United States in terms of pushing forwards human rights globally, in terms of pushing forwards democracy globally, in terms of working on the fight against hunger? It has been the European Union. I know, again, China is coming to play a very important role also on the development sphere, and we fully recognize that and fully support it. The amount of capital they're putting into Africa has been very important. But overall, this transatlantic relationship is still core and will remain core for a very long time. So we're very proud to have the opportunity to play a leading role in directing it. And I think we do have a chance to do that, particularly because of our current generation of leaders. In Ireland, we just had some political changes. In a way, not too dramatic. The same party is still in power that was in before. That's the Fine Gael party, which in our system, we have two, our political system is very centrist. Both the two main parties are basically dead in the center. One is sometimes slightly more to the left, and one is sometimes slightly more to the right. So Fine Gael, which is the slightly more to the right party, is still in power in Ireland, but they've elected a new leader. And he's caused a bit of a fuss globally. There was a big Times magazine profile about him because, as they said in Time, as they said also in the New York Times, he was, this conservative country, Ireland, has suddenly elected an Indian gay prime minister. And that, of course, it shook people up and made great headlines. But we were kind of surprised on him because we really hadn't actually noticed that he was Indian, and we hadn't really paid much attention to the fact that he was gay. Neither of those things were really relevant. And that's something that I'm very proud of about Irish people. We just didn't see those things. We weren't particularly conscious of it. It wasn't really part of the discussion. We just liked him because he was a straight talker. And he was a bit edgy, and he seemed to be different from your average politician. I mean, edgy not in terms of his background, but in terms of what he actually said, the direct way he dealt with political issues that were difficult. So that's why we've in Ireland we've chosen this gay Indian Prime Minister, Leo Varadkar, and we're very glad about the leadership that he's going to offer. And again, a lot of the people around him are quite similar in terms of having been very smart, very articulate, committed Europeans who've never known Ireland to be not part of the European Union, but with people who have a very, very clear and committed focus on the United States. So before I came to give this lecture, I looked back at the speeches of our new Prime Minister, Leo Varadkar, And almost every single speech has a big, long quote from a US president that forms the basis of the speech, every single one. And also his catch cry for the new agenda he's delivering for Ireland is to create a republic of opportunity. That sounds pretty American to me. And again, Leo Varadkar worked previously, he's since he was a child, basically, he's been in the Fine Gael party in Ireland, but he also has had some of his political training here in the United States. Leo Varadkar worked as an assistant to a Republican congressman called, a Republican member of the US Congress called Jack Quinn. So he has deep ties to this country. And he has been out here to the United States on many occasions as our Minister for Transport and Tourism. He was down in Miami, he was in Atlanta. He's got a sense of this region very, very well. And so I think we can continue to see him playing in a very important role in maintaining that focus in Ireland. We are Europeans, but we're our perspective is very American in outlook. So I think he's going to help us to continue to be and to become more of a bridge between the European Union and the United States. And that's something that I personally am very happy about. So thank you. That's the end of my comments. Thank you for listening to me. And I've got some tough questions.
Preparing for the possible economic consequences from Brexit?
Well, we're doing a lot. All of our national economic agencies have been given increased budgets to specifically try and mitigate the damage from Brexit. Also, we're very focused as partners on the EU side in the Brexit negotiations on shaping those negotiations to our advantage so that the impact of Brexit will be as little as possible. Specifically, what we're pushing for in terms of trade is the most open possible trading relationship between the European Union and the UK. I mean, ultimately, we'd like the UK to stay in the European Union. If they won't do that, we'd like them to stay in the single market. And if they can't do that, we'd like them at least to stay in the customs union. So we want the negotiations to go in that direction. We're only one party on the EU side of the negotiations, and the negotiations will inherently be difficult. I mean, you can't, if you leave a club, whether it's a golf club or a badminton club or whatever kind of club it is, and you stop paying your membership fee and you say, I don't want to be a member of the club anymore, you can't continue to have all the benefits of membership. So that's basically the situation the UK is in now. So the negotiations will be difficult. But we're working hard to, as I said, shape the negotiations as much as we can to reduce the negative economic impacts of Brexit on us. And we're doing the best we can to help our companies adjust and to diversify. So they're going to be hopefully exporting even more to the US and Asia and Africa and reducing their exposure to the UK. And already Brexit has hurt, even though Brexit hasn't happened, Brexit has already hurt us because perceptions of Brexit have affected the pound sterling, which has dropped in value. And that means that the euro is relatively more expensive now in the UK, which means that Irish agricultural exports have, since the day Brexit was announced, become more expensive. So that's already hurting our farmers, already causing us troubles. So the economic impacts of Brexit are a big concern for us, and mitigating them is now one of the number one priorities for our government.
Although it might be difficult to predict or say at this time, do you feel like they might come to some agreement in terms of Brexit and the Northern Ireland, Irish border, that there would be some special status for that border, or do you feel like that they wouldn't allow for it?
I really can't predict how negotiations will go. We're waiting for new proposals from the UK side as to how they will help to solve the problem. we know there's goodwill on all sides, but it just the devil will be in the detail, and we're just going to have to see. You know, I can't predict how exactly it will be, but it's hard to see that it will be better than what we currently have. What we currently have is the ideal arrangement. There is really no visible economic border. We use two different currencies on each side of the border, but other than that, there's almost no economic border between Ireland and Northern Ireland, and we want to continue, ideally, to see that there'll be no economic border between Ireland and Northern Ireland. There is a political border, they're part of the UK. We don't want to see an economic border between Ireland and Northern Ireland.
Beyond Brexit, in terms of further EU integration efforts across the board, what does Ireland hope to see in the future along those lines?
Well, we want, I think, that's a big question. But I think we want things to go in a market-orientated direction, I think, broadly speaking. That's part of what our focus. We want the European Union, I think, to focus on the things it does best. And we can see cooperation advancing in many areas in that regard. But I don't think, you know, across the European Union, there's a much of an interest in sort of, you know, in cooperation for cooperation's sense. It has to be productive and sensible. The European Union does leave some things to member states and does things, some things collectively. Trade does so well collectively. Competition policy does generally, in most regards, very well collectively. And there are other things which are better left to member states. So it's, we'll see. It's going to be, you know, we've had a lot of, there were a lot of, in recent times, there were a lot of discussions about further integration in the last few decades. So, let's see if things move forward as quickly. We'll have to just see.
Ireland's done a great job making themselves very attractive in the global markets, and wage and unemployment have been improving ever since the economic crisis. But lately, there's been some conversation about Irish economy actually overheating potentially in the near future.
Yes, well, it's a very good point. The potential area of overheating is probably the property market. The property market was the area where the property market, in tandem with our banks, was what went wrong in the financial crisis period for Ireland and led us to having to take on massive debts as a state and as citizens. Because our private commercial banks went bankrupt. So that was our big problem of recent years. So we are, we totally overhauled our system of regulation in Ireland, both in terms of financial services and in terms of the property market. But it's still an area we have to watch. We are watching the property sector very carefully. There hasn't, we were not happy about the rate of building of new properties. That is a concern. We're trying to push now for more commercial properties to be built. And also there has been a lack of private residential properties as well. So we have also been, if you look at sort of the current government's priorities, housing is really number one priority these days at home in terms of the domestic objective, increasing the housing supply for ordinary people. So that aspect is one where we're very focused, and we're trying to make sure that we deal with any risks. I think that's the main, that's the negative side of it covered. Other than that, our unemployment rate is going down very, very fast. You know, we had unemployment rate, I think, of over 15% in 2012. We brought it down in a very dramatic way. So it's just over about 6.2% today. So that's a really, truly radical transformation, which shows the resilience of Irish people, their capacity to reskill. It shows that in the European Union, there's that liberal economic model that would always like to see applied to labour markets works. You know, some of the Polish people who came in to work in our construction sector went back to Poland when our construction sector died off, or went to Germany, or moved around. So a lot of those factors are working quite well. Stop overheating. And again, the fact that we're part of the European Union and open to everyone in the European Union coming in means that we more workers can come in on the labour market to help. help our labour market if we have shortages and if wages start getting too high. So overall, I think, and again, we've totally overhauled the way in which we administer our central bank, the way in which our Department of Finance works. All of that has been radically overhauled, and we're paying back. We just announced this week that we're paying back some of the loans we got in the financial crisis early. And our debt, we're now able to borrow money almost the same level as Germany now, in international bond markets. So I think in terms of our financial management of recent years, it's been very prudent, it's been very effective, and we've got a good deal for Ireland. I think overall the economy's in very good shape. And I haven't even mentioned, I'm here doing a sort of a promotional talk, but I haven't even mentioned that we've been the fastest growing economy in the European Union for the about four years in a row. And without overheating, I think, except with some concerns in the property market area, which we are working on. Thank you for the question.
From the perspective of a nation trying to attract business, how has the Irish government been mitigating any possible damages from the EU regulatory ruling about Google recently?
What about Apple, was it?
I'm fairly certain it was a massive fines levied against Google for having certain biases.
Yes, I think I did hear about that, but I'm not aware of. And Google has a very big presence in Ireland, as I already mentioned, and we'd like the company to do well and to continue its presence in Ireland. But I don't have a particular briefing or position on that decision. But as I said already, very often DG Competition does a good job. We don't agree with their decision on the Apple case. About that if you wanted, but I don't have a particular view on their decision on Google. A great company, we love having them in Ireland, and DG Competition often does a good job as well, so I don't have any particular comment on that individual case.
Could you talk about Apple then?
Apple, yes. Apple, so that was a decision by the European Commission, generally one of our best friends, the European Commission, and generally we very much like DG Competition, who's done a great job in regulating competition across the European Union decades in a very respected body. But we think they really got it absolutely wrong on the Apple case. They forced Apple to pay a sort of a fine to Ireland, I think it was about 14 billion or something along those lines, which we put into we were forced to take it and put it into a sort of a holding account. But we've taken the European Commission to the European Court, because they made a mistake with the decision. Under European Union laws, taxation is a member state competency. So rules on taxation are decided by the member states as a whole, not by the European Commission or the European Parliament or by the community method. We have concerns about the Commission having overreached its competencies in this case. As I said, that's more the general political point. But we also are very conscious that in the Apple case, the Apple ruling came in the context, it wasn't that sort of a tax decision, it was a competition decision. And that ruling said that we were participating in anti-competitive practices. So it's saying that we gave a special deal to Apple. And so in Ireland, we never give special deals to any individual company. We never, ever do that. It may happen in some other countries, but we never give special deals to companies. The arrangement that Apple put in place through tax planning through the United States and Ireland and perhaps other countries, which I'm not fully up on, was one that they discovered with their tax planners, invented with their tax planners, and it was open to any company to plan their affairs in that same way. Under the law of Ireland as it existed at that time. So there was no special deal given to Apple. So it was not an anti-competitive practice by us. There was no state aid. We shouldn't have had to pay a fine. So that's basically the simple version of the story. So we disagree with the European Commission's decision in this matter, and we're taking them to court, and we'll win. It'll probably take a few years, but we'll win on that because they've misunderstood our laws, how we apply our laws, and the inherent nature of the acquis in this area. Sorry, maybe I saw your hand first, but I'm not sure who was first. Let me go for you first.
You mentioned a referendum with Northern Ireland to be able to determine its status within the UK and with Ireland.
Yes.
And when I was in Ireland, I was like urged not to visit Belfast and Northern Ireland during the anniversary of Alan Boyne. And when I did visit Belfast, I was shocked at the contrast between Protestant communities and Catholic communities. And I was curious as to what you thought when there could be a referendum and what you thought that that could be in coming years with population changes and different amounts of Catholics and Protestants.
Yeah, it's always an interesting question. The main thing I'd say is that we're not pushing for a referendum at the moment. I know a gentleman called Mr. Gerry Adams, who represents the Sinn Féin party that operates in Northern Ireland and also in Ireland. He has pushed for such a referendum in the context of Brexit. But we're not pushing for one. We don't think it's helpful at this time. We are not, what we're focused on in terms of Northern Ireland is full implementation of the Good Friday Agreement, which was approved by the people of Ireland and Northern Ireland simultaneously, and has, in our view, complete legitimacy, and is the sound rock on which the peace process and progress in Northern Ireland in general should be built. That's what we're very focused on. Population shifts may happen in Northern Ireland. People may change their perspectives. Not everybody who's Catholic votes, you know, wants to stay, join Ireland. Not everyone who's Protestant wants to stay in the UK. These things vary. And I'm sorry you saw some animosity. And there is animosity in certain places and certain communities. But great progress has been achieved since it stopped being a sort of hot fighting war in Northern Ireland, conflict in Northern Ireland, since the troubles have subsided. There has been great progress seen that things are getting better. And through, you know, active engagement by Ireland and the UK and the European Union, we've been helping to bring communities closer together. We're very focused on that. And in fact, even here, in my job as Consul General, I do some work in that regard. I work quite closely with a body called the Ulster Scots Agency, which has a particular legitimacy in Ireland for representing that Scots-Irish perspective here. So I work closely with them, and they're politically, they're really quite close to the DUP, which is the party of Ian Paisley, you know, the quite a sort of a the more conservative party of the Northern Ireland Unionist perspective. But I work closely with them and help represent their views and help distribute their brochures here. And I was even talking earlier today with UNC about bringing them into a cultural project we're planning here. So deeply, as an Irish government, we're committed to working in partnership with people in Northern Ireland, even when they have different perspectives with us on things, and we're committed to fully implementing the Good Friday Agreement. And that's what we're all about. Sorry.
That was actually my question. I was going to ask about the possibility of a referendum. So, thank you.
We'll see. And we don't, not all Catholics and Protestants get on badly in Ireland, because my wife is Catholic, and we sometimes agree about things, but I'm Protestant, despite being from the south. So it's not. In general, things are more complicated than you might think by sometimes watching the news. Sorry,
Catherine. Yeah, thanks. I'm curious about Irish perspective on the recent European Court of Justice ruling regarding refugees and against Hungary and Slovakia, and how your government feels about the ruling, but also the refugee crisis is clearly multi-layered and complicated and played a role in Brexit, and I don't know how many refugees Ireland has taken. I don't know what that looks like. Unfortunately, sorry, I don't have those numbers, but I'd be curious on your perspective on what your government is feeling in this regard.
Yes, thank you for asking that question. And again, I have to apologize because I'm not really up on that ruling.
Sure.
I haven't, and I don't know what our position is on it, actually.
Okay.
But we are very aware that there has been a migration, major migration crisis, which has been a huge disruptor for Europe as a whole, especially in terms of people fleeing from terrible hardship in Syria and elsewhere. We're fully cognizant of that. On a practical basis, sometimes we don't get as many people landing in Ireland as they do in Greece and Italy and those places. But on that, our perspective on that is that, you know, being part of the European Union makes us much stronger in dealing with that kind of major. I mean, I don't want to talk about fleeing innocent people as a threat, but it is a disruption. It is a thing that can unsettle, can cause huge problems. But our capacity to manage such huge regional crises is much greater because we're part of the European Union, much greater. I mean, a deal has been done with Turkey in recent times, which is part of our approach for managing migration. You know, Ireland wouldn't have been doing that deal on its own. It's a deal that's done as part of the European Union. And we're also very conscious that, while we're not on the front line in terms of the refugees hitting us, that we are obliged as members of the European Union to do our fair share. So we've been certainly very, very willing to take our proportionate fair share of our refugees into Ireland. And I think we've also, I'm not very much up on it, but I think we've done put in place a special bilateral arrangement with Greece, which is sort of, I think, fast-tracking some more people coming directly over as part of a sort of facilitating mechanism for that overall approach. And also we have a small army in Ireland and a small navy, but our naval service has been based in the Mediterranean for the last year or so, pulling refugees, asylum seekers, and unfortunately sometimes people who have already passed away out of the waters of the Mediterranean. And again, we're, like others, very, very focused on political efforts to try and stop the causes of the violence which are leading to these refugee flows. And we're very committed to investing through development in some of the refugee communities, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, who flow up to Europe to make decisions, give them a choice, let's say, about what they do. So we are very, very focused on those issues, and of course, migration is one of the big threats now, which we all have to deal with in the European Union too. We are very much focused on it. And again, you do need clear, strong policies from time to time on migration issues. We also changed my instincts are very liberal, and I think you always like to be open and welcoming in Ireland. We did have to change our constitution a few years ago because too many people were coming in to Ireland and claiming asylum, getting residence, and then using Ireland as a backdoor into the UK. That was happening. And so we had, like the United States, we traditionally had a rule that anyone born in Ireland was automatically an Irish citizen. But misuse of that, people were misusing that law to get into the UK by unfair means, so we actually had to change our constitution. So we have taken, at times, measures that we wouldn't want to take to stop problems of that sort of escalating.
So the Irish disposition to promote human rights as a policy, what sort of attitudes does the Irish government take toward the illiberal political developments in Poland and Czechoslovakia?
Yes, I'm not actually properly briefed on those things. At the moment, I haven't been following them very closely since I've been based here in the States. And there would have been European Council probably comments on these things. And whatever the European Council came out with, Ireland would have been there negotiating the wordings, as it always is. So I think I would point to the latest official statements from the European Council and the European Commission on these things as probably quite representative of our views. We do you know, value the core principles of the European Union in terms of human rights and democracy in those areas. And again, you know, all of us also need to look inwards. In every country, in Ireland, there are issues we work on the human rights front, but we're not perfect as well. And we're conscious of that, like any country. But I can't. I'm not in a position really to give a. I don't have a briefing on what our position is on the policies that you just mentioned.
You may have spoken to some of this earlier with the question about the Irish economy, but what do you feel were some of the factors that allowed Ireland to weather the 2007 financial crisis so well compared to countries like Greece, Spain, and Italy, whose economies were crippled by it and are still having a lot of trouble recovering?
Yes, well, I'm not in the business of sort of criticizing other EU partners, but I can say that in the Irish case, the government took a very strong lead, and Irish people came behind them. We saw that there was a great problem that we were facing. It was a major financial crisis, and that we had to accept very bitter medicine if we weren't going to make our economy well again. So ordinary citizens and all around the country took a lot of pain in terms of to deal with the crisis, because they knew we had to do that as a country. So I'm very proud of the resilience that Irish people showed and the leadership that the Irish government showed in addressing the crisis. I mean, one example is Irish civil servants. All Irish civil servants took major salary cuts in practice. Because of a new form of a taxation that was put on automatically onto our salaries, so that was part of it. And but many Irish people, of course, lost their jobs and had to reskill. So it was really the Irish people and the Irish government together who took strong actions and solved the problem. Also, you have to remember that the internationally focused part of our economy remained quite strong throughout. It was more the domestic side of our economy, particularly the banking and property, which was badly hit during the financial crisis. The externally focused part of our economy, the exporting section of our economy, remained strong even throughout the financial crisis in general. So that allowed some balancing, which is very important. Also, I mean, there was a whole range of measures that the Irish government took to help our situation. You know, we took loans, and then in some cases we renegotiated them and paid them back earlier, or negotiated good terms and did sort of things with management of debt that was quite prudent through our you know, government debt management agency. So that worked quite well. Speaking to you, I'm conscious there's a camera there, so I'm automatically speaking a bit more correctly. Sir?
So on a lighter note, I guess to start on behalf of the UNC Public Club, we'd love to have you out on Friday for one of our training sessions. We'll still be in town. We'd love to have you take part. Having interned for the Shannon in 2003 and sort of followed, obviously, the country closely since then, it's been quite a roller coaster ride over the last 10 or 15 years. Where do you see sort of, I guess from a business perspective, the psyche of the Irish people at this point, in terms of all that they've overcome and the new challenges that are on the way from either Brexit or other opportunities, and where do you maybe see undervalued chances to maybe broaden the business relationship between Ireland and the United States, sort of beyond the multinationals that maybe get the most attention?
Yes. Lots of parts to your question there, but maybe to start with the last one. There has been talk historically, or about, you know, the economic relationship being dominated by big multinationals from the US. But I am very conscious from my own direct personal experience of the fact that there have been a lot of Irish companies, Irish indigenous companies, have grown up in and around those big US multinationals in Ireland. For example, there's a company called VoxPro, which was founded in Cork, which grew up servicing the big US high-end IT companies. And it was so effective at that, they invited it to go out and work in California, service them there. And then, not long ago, it set up a base as well in Athens, Georgia. I think it has operations elsewhere as well. But that's a great example of an Irish indigenous company that grew up in the margins of those great US multinationals, and then became a source of employment and important economic activity here. And we've seen many examples like that. There's another Irish company called E&I Engineering, which is now has a big operation in Anderson, South Carolina. They produce heavy switch equipment gear for hospitals and for data centers, for example. They're a great Irish company, and they again were very successful in servicing the needs of US multinationals in Ireland, and were invited to come out and do that same good work with their new US headquarters being in Anderson, South Carolina. Another Irish company, Mergon, was the same thing. They produce parts for BMW. They produce parts, which of course the biggest BMW plant I think in the world is, if I'm not mistaken, is in Spartanburg, South Carolina. So Mergon now have a base in Anderson, South Carolina. So we see many of these patterns. The relationship is much more diverse than you would think. But I would never be inclined to be critical of those U.S. multinationals. They produced that ecosystem in which these Irish companies grew up in, and were then able to come over here and return the favor in terms of producing jobs, employment, and in some cases also technology transfer from Ireland to the U.S. So it's a great story which is rolling out now. And in terms of usually the unrealized commercial potential is something that the company will get. Me as a civil servant, I'm not probably going to be the one normally who sees it before them. They have that those entrepreneurs have that instinct, which like entrepreneurs in this country, and they know what to do. I think I may have answered all your questions. Do you want to repeat one of the other ones? I'm delighted to hear that you're good at hurling. That's our ancient Irish sport, thousands of years old, played by our folklore heroes like Lugh Cullen. And it's wonderful to see how it's become hugely popular now in the southern United States. And here it's mostly played by non-Irish people. Most of the players, I would estimate, aren't even Irish Americans. But there's Americans who are fascinated by this fast and brilliant sport. So it's a great story.
Mostly we're led by somebody from Mayo who's occupied this weekend with other things.
Because my wife is from Mayo, so I know it's a good place.
Yes.
Glad to hear you worked in our Shannon. Our Shannon was nearly erased a little while ago, but our people in a referendum didn't agree with the government on that. They agreed with the government on government proposal on establishing gay marriage in Ireland. They voted for that, certainly, but they didn't agree with voting to abolish the Shannon. So our previous government didn't get through all its proposals.
Since I heard the word internship and I heard students talking about it, I'm going to ask shamelessly on behalf of all of our wonderful students. We have a lot of undergrad and postgraduate students who might be looking for employment. Do you have any tips for, maybe general tips for people seeking employment in Ireland? If you see trends of certain industries or places people might look for employment in Ireland, either in Ireland or with Irish companies, or also maybe if you have more specific opportunities that you know of, because we have a lot of people that might be curious about those.
Yes, sure. Well, a lot of the Irish companies here, I know, are keen to get high quality talented staff. So those manufacturing companies I mentioned in Anderson, South Carolina, are certainly keen to get talented staff. I mean, this is more a liberal arts audience, but again, I know their head of human resources is a locally recruited, I think he's a liberal arts graduate, I'm not 100% sure, but I think so. And again, it's the same thing with this Irish company, Oldcastle, which now employs 40,000 people in this country. And those are good places to look for employment if you have the right skill set. And could be good as well. I'm only imagining this. I can't speak on behalf of the companies, but you'd imagine that some of these companies now that operate between like Ireland and America might be interested in American interns working for them in Ireland. It could be quite interesting, especially if you have sort of niche skills. But there are now, as you know, a lot of American companies working over there in Ireland, so they might quite like to have a few Americans in with their mix. Just to try it, see what we can get. Unfortunately, we haven't any, in a very small consulate, we haven't got any internship program at the moment. It was a wonderful experience for me working with the European Commission as an intern. I think, I'm not sure if they may take in some Americans there as well.
A small
number. And again, the UN, of course, takes in interns as well, which is very competitive. But again, an interesting thing to try and do. And again, it should be a great opportunity as well to get involved in politics as well, working with your state legislature, with your in governor's office or in places like that, senators and congressmen, and there'll be lots of opportunity. Congresswomen. Yeah.
I just have one last question, if I may. Is anyone else? I'll let you go first. Yeah, go ahead.
I did not get the number of jobs that were created in the United States for Irish companies.
It is between 80 and 100,000.
80 and 100,000?
Between 80 and 100. We don't know the exact number.
Okay.
It's around 140,000, roughly, produced by American companies in Ireland. But one company, the dramatic thing, and easy thing to remember, is that one Irish company, Oldcastle, employs 40,000 Americans. I met them again last week, so I'm pretty clear about that fact.
Yeah.
So, finally.
How many citizens does the consulate actually serve, and which state in your area has the highest population of Irish citizens?
Okay, you think this would be the easiest question to answer, but it's not. It's not. Irish citizens don't make a habit of registering with us, so we really don't know. And probably your local immigration authority would know more about it than me, or the tourism. Tourism board, so I know more about it than me. We just don't know. What we do know about are the census figures. So the US census figures are very interesting, and they show that overall in the US, it's around 10 or 11% of people claim Irish heritage. And we track also the breakdown in the various different states. So in South Carolina and North Carolina, I think there's more than average, it's about 12%. Their primary heritage. So that's something we can track quite easily. I'm conscious of there being quite a lot of young Irish people, relatively speaking, here in Raleigh and in Charlotte. I know they're both fast-growing cities anyway, which are attractive to sort of millennial type of people. And also in Charlotte, some healthcare workers from Ireland are working in Charlotte as well, some physios are working there. So that's part of the pattern, but I don't have real numbers. But definitely, there, in terms of young Irish-born people, there are good numbers here in Raleigh, good numbers in Charlotte, good numbers in Atlanta. There are some of the decent numbers around Miami. Those are some of the hubs. But they're probably similar to the hubs where people are moving anyway. Like Charleston also gets a smaller number, but decent number of young Irish people. Nashville, something similar.
Okay, I'm going to ask my controversial question at dinner.
Okay,
but I just want to say thank you so much for coming.
Much,
it's really a pleasure to have your perspective. It's interesting to hear what a diplomat has to say. We don't hear it every day. So thank you. Thanks to all of you for coming. Thanks for engaging in our Center for European Studies dialogue on a regular basis. Okay, one more thing from Sophie. European Horizons meets every Wednesday at 6. Join us in discussing interesting topics on a weekly basis. All are welcome. If you are interested in becoming a Euro major, which is also very exciting, come see me on the third floor. And hopefully you're getting our newsletter already. We do events like this exciting one on a regular basis. And we have Brexit next, the Brexit discussion with Gary Marks and Christiana Lemke next Tuesday night, then Christiana Lemke's take on the German elections the week after, and the Turkey Turkey Today series is moving, you know, all sorts of stuff happening at the school. So, but really, thank you very much.